And now we're going to welcome Chris out from the Netherlands. So, Chris, get yourself on the stage with me here, please, if you're around. All right, there's Chris. So, Chris and I, we go way back. We've hung out at tons of events and so on. And also, Chris recently wrote a book on extreme revenue growth. And we're going to hear all about it, what that is. So, Chris, the stage is yours.
Thanks, Pep. Can everybody hear me well? Yes. Okay, let's go. So, of course, I'm super excited to be here because I think I'm in an somehow elite group right now that was invited by Pep to speak at Elite Camp, CXL Live, and now also at Winter Games. So I'm really, really happy about that. I'm really passionate about go-to-market strategies, doing things fast, make sure that you can do it in a smarter way, because as you can see over here, I've worked with the biggest companies in the world, startups, scale-ups, and tried to help them to generate millions extra in revenue. Wrote a book about that. I will share a little bit about that later on, but first let's go into the media stuff of today. Because I think as Pep also shared in all the announcements that he did leading up to this event, there is a very big go-to-market challenge. We see that everywhere the cost is going up. And why is that? Because everybody is doing the same. What has worked until now, everybody has copied it. So we need something different. But a lot of companies are not doing that. And why is that? The first reason, they are too slow. Too slow in action and too slow in decision making. So this is something that I see with a lot of clients. They are too slow in their decision making, so therefore it's not taking off. Why are they making it? Why is it going too slow? Because they're making things complicated. So stop making things complicated and make it more simple. Because what do a lot of these companies do? They forget to leverage what's already in front of them. They don't see it. And what I've done with my book and what I will share with you in this short keynote is that I really believe that in every business, there's a hidden gold mine of growth in front of you. You only don't see it yet, and you only don't know how to act with it. And what I want to do today is give you the tools, the mindset, and the mental models to go over there. Because if you do that, you can increase your speed of execution. You can make your go-to-market cheaper. And most importantly, you can have more impact. And especially doing it fast. Because just do this. Want to know how to do that? I'm helping a lot of clients doing this. This is a screenshot of one of my clients. I think that only a couple of people in this room can deconstruct this. But this was a setting where a client wanted to create a new business from scratch. And within 33 minutes, he had his first paying client. Because I'm all about that. Go to market fast, ask people, are you willing to pay for it, and transfer me the money? Because if you do that, that's the ultimate validation. Or another client who was selling courses for 497 euros, and I told them, this is not the market you need to be in. You need to create a 10K proposition or even more. And within 1 month, they generated a couple of clients, which helped them massively to take on the next step. So be aware, it can go fast. But where do you start when you do all of this? Well, I think the first mistake that a lot of companies are making, of course, as I shared, they make it too expensive, they're doing the traditional things, because they're not doing ecosystem thinking. And what do I mean with ecosystem thinking is that every business is an ecosystem of products and services. I think the fact that we're over here is, I think that Pep shared this in a lot of his posts, is that you come into contact with Pep or the team through one of their companies, and you buy more and more services and products. And why do you do that? Because they help you. The events, Digital Elite Camp, CXL Live, they're all great events. And what they do, they give you trust. And what you need to do when you want to be smart about your go-to-market is to take it into account that every product that you create creates trust if you perform well, especially the first product. So that's why you need to think from an ecosystem perspective, because almost all companies sell more than one product or services. So these products and services impact each other. It's really hard to go to market if the previous product experience that somebody had with you was already bad. So you want to make sure that that foundation is strong. And of course, it's easier said than done. But what I believe and what I've seen, especially in the last year when I'm doing a lot of one-on-one consulting with clients, is that to visualize this ecosystem, they need a framework. And the framework that I use a lot to guide my clients with their go-to-market is the concept of a value ladder. But what's really interesting, and this was highly surprising to me, is when I run a poll on LinkedIn about how many people actually know about a value ladder, I saw that more than 50% of my network, they didn't even know what a value ladder was. And to be honest, it also was 2 years ago for me that I first got exposed to this framework. But once I really started to understand that framework, I started to see, okay, how were the businesses where I bought a lot of courses, a lot of products, or a lot of services from, how had they installed a value ladder, and how did they make sure that I became a very profitable customer for them? Because we're talking here about go-to-market strategies. So this is the ecosystem that you have to fill in. You want to fill in all these steps, because what's a value ladder, at least as how I'm describing it, it's offices and service really strategically placed in a series that go up in value and price. So it's a ladder, which means that everything should be connected. And this is where a mistake that I also see a lot of companies make is they do launches or go to market in isolation. But I always try to see it within an ecosystem. How can you go to market with something that is leveraged on top of the value ladder that you already have? And I think a great example that I analyzed last year, where I was exposed to, and which I also documented in my book, was the $55 Be on TV Bootcamp Challenge with Jen Gottlieb and Chris Winfield from the company Superconnector Media. And I think it's part of my job that a thing that I really love is that if I see somebody launching like this, I'm creating all kinds of screenshots. I document the sales pages because I want to really understand what they are doing. How are they doing this go-to-market in the smartest way possible? So what they're selling over here is a $55 challenge. But what was really cool to notice and to break down is that on the first sale, so on day one, they were already able to more than double the value that they got from a customer. Because how did this work? So I filled in the value ladder over here. So it started with a bootcamp. And what they did with that bootcamp, once you signed up for that first $55, and I saw that more than 700 people had done that for the Facebook group and 5 days of live trainings, you immediately got two upsells. One for extra calls with them, but also another upsell, which was a recording of an event which they previously hosted, where people normally had to pay $5,000 for. But by doing this on the first sale, when somebody was on a buying high, they were already able to double the price that they could charge somebody. In other words, a very smart go-to-market strategy could be to test if somebody is already buying from you and they are in that buying high, could you already upsell or cross-sell a new offering and see if they're willing to pay for that? Because they're already at that high. If they don't buy it at that moment, then you know that you probably need to do some more research. So increasing the value on the first sale was already really interesting as a go-to-market strategy. But what was even more interesting is that they were able to increase the customer value in year one with a crazy percentage. And I'm sharing what they've done right now. And afterwards, I will deconstruct it and show you a 7-step process on how you can also do this in your business. Because at the end, what they were selling, they had this bootcamp. After that, you could sign up for an 8-week course, online courses, or an accelerator where people had to pay $2,000 or $5,000 per course for. They could even get into a VIP session with them, or even the high-end services where they charge up to like $130,000 per year. by breaking down their entire funnel, the front end, so the money made on the first sale, but also the back end, I could analyze that for every dollar they made on day one, within 1 year, they were able to increase that amount by more than 7 times. So, which means that, in other words, the average client value, which they were able to generate in total, was more than $800. So what's interesting, they're going to market with a new challenge that's costing you $55, but they're able to turn it in more than $800 client value per client. So everybody that they were selling to. What was really interesting to deconstruct from this is that in the sequence on how they did that. So the first thing they did is they already had their high-end services. So what they did, they took their high-end services, moved downstream with lower offering, cheaper offerings, with a little bit less value, but at a lower price. But by doing that, they had a chain of different services and they could leverage the ecosystem that they already have. So then probably a lot of you guys are asking, yeah, that's interesting for a consulting business, for a training business, but how does this framework apply to software as a services? I think it's also a very big part of a lot of SaaS offerings, because implementing a value ladder in a SaaS business is nothing else than adding or removing features, but also adding or removing consulting and support. And I think that there's, in that consulting and support, adding or removing features, that there's a nuance over there, which a lot of SaaS businesses are missing on, where I've seen that if you implement that in a smart way, it can be a huge leverage for you. And I'll share that later in this keynote. So why is this ecosystem so important for your go-to-market strategy? Because you should always think in terms of leveraging. You're building a system and you want to increase the return that you have on that. So where do you start by building this ecosystem? As I said, I have a 7-step process where I either guide my clients through, or you can read about more in the book. And step one is you need to map your value ladder. And I think a very interesting value ladder that I got exposed to years ago was from Ramit Sethi from the book, I Will Teach You to Be Rich. And what's really interesting, if you look from a lead magnet perspective, he was helping people to solve different use cases. So in this case, how to earn more money. But you could buy a book, add a productivity course, go to an earn 1K course, and or six-figure consulting. And what's really interesting to see is that on a high level, the use case is the same, earn more money, be productive. But he was guiding me from that first offer through that value chain to the top. But if I go back to the next slide, from a buying perspective, from a go-to-market perspective, that productivity pack course of $147 was the first product I bought from him. But I can share with you that at that time, I wasn't making a lot of money and I was super afraid to buy that course because it was $170 and it was a lot of money at that time. I didn't trust it, but I wanted to give it a go. So I went through that course, got results, and a couple of months later, I bought the Earn 1K course, where you learn how to earn 1,000 per month on the site. That course was also successful. So then I went through the other offer where you can earn 100K per year. At least that's what he's teaching you. But if you look at these numbers, so the $147 course, I was more afraid to buy and click the buy button at that moment compared to buying the 7.5K course, which was 50 times more expensive. And that's something also really interesting for you to pay attention to. How can you guide people through an ecosystem that even a product or service that's 50 times more expensive becomes a no-brainer for you? So step one, mapping your value ladder is listing it. Step two, mapping the offers and the value propositions over there. And then you're going to assess it. So do they follow a logical progression? Is value going up in a logical way? Is the price going up in a logical way? Because what you want to do is you want to figure out what has the strongest price to quality ratio. Because why is the trust going up? Why was it for me easier to buy the 7.5K product instead of the $147 product, because the earlier products and services I was exposed to, they were a lot cheaper, but they increased trust with me. So another thing that's also really interesting to figure out when you are going to market is, are you adding products and services that are actually opening up the desire for the next product that is a little bit higher on your value ladder, with a higher price and more value? But it's also interesting to see, are you missing products on your value ladder? And a good way to do that is to assess what your competitors are doing, what their value ladder is, and map that also on top of yours to see, okay, where there are any gaps. And then the next thing, and this is a little bit more advanced, is you want to go into a mindset of derivative thinking. And what's a derivative is you already have something and you take a derivative from that. So what you see a lot in this space is that you first create a workshop and out of that you create an online course. Or you get some insights in one-on-one coaching, where you get paid for your time. And out of that, you create a lead magnet, which is way more scalable. And what I see people do wrong a lot of times is that they start with the derivatives first instead of the source, which can actually enable you to create a lot of derivatives out of that. And that's also what I will share with you later, is which type of assets can you build in the best way possible so you can create the most derivatives out of that. A key mindset that I use in finding the best sources to create derivatives from is to look, okay, what's already working really well and how can I create derivatives out of that? As I said, we start with a value ladder, but what I wanted to do in my book is to really get to the essence of that and deconstruct all the components to see where can we tweak, where can we do things in a smarter way to actually make sure that we can increase our speed and make more impact. And the first thing that I did in terms of the value ladder is separate human touch and digital touch on each step of the ladder. Because a human touch point on a journey, you could say, is this is where a human needs to be involved. And if you look, for example, at customer support, you can do two things. You can create an FAQ, which is online. So that would be a digital touch. Or a human touch would be a customer support person that actually talks to you. So if you look at this value ladder, the touch-based value ladder, is you can see that you can be strategic about on which step of the ladder you use which amount of digital touch and which amount of human touch. Because at the end, you want to find the optimal mix for each step on the ladder to increase the return on investment from each step. And when you assess return on investment, you're also thinking about the return on that step, but also how is it opening up the desire for the next step, and how can you make sure that ride from low on the value ladder to higher on the value ladder becomes as easy as possible. But there's another angle that I've used to deconstruct the value ladder even more and to make it more applicable to increase go-to-market speed. Because next to deconstructing human touch and digital touch, I've also assessed, can you look at the flexibility of things? Because in a lot of cases, you could say that human touch, changing a phone script, changing how you say things, can be very flexible, can be done pretty quickly. Or at the other end, you could say changing one line of code or changing an ad, that can be something that can be done really fast. But that's all dependent on the context. Because if your salespeople are really busy and they don't see it yet, they want more training or they first want to do other stuff, you could say that from the outside, you would say the first thing is that it's flexible, but actually it's really fixed. They make it really hard and you won't get it done within 30 days. And actually maybe changing that line of code can still be flexible. So when you look at this matrix, you want to assess where can we be flexible, because over there, in which type of touches, that's where you can make speed. Because what you want to do is you want to go to market with reinventable assets. So a common mistake that I see people make is to go to market as a one-off. So they do something once and then they just leave it. But what I do is before we develop something, before we create something, we already think, how can we build it in a modular way so we can repackage or repurpose all the things that we have built. Because in this combination, it might not work, but if we're able to repackage some of the things that we've done or repurpose it, then we can still get a return on the time that we spent right now. And this is what I call modular asset building. Yeah? It's a combination of processes and systems. That's an asset. Huh? It can run without you. And as I can see over here, I had to make a screenshot of a PDF and not my keynote. So I see it's not super clear. But what you see over here is the difference between an asset and what's not an asset. So for example, sending out a sales email, just one time doing it, that's not an asset. You have done it once. But if it works, you create an automated flow out of it. Yeah, so then it becomes an asset. You can repurpose it, you can change it, and you can use it in other circumstances. But also, like creating a social media post from scratch versus having already templates, having a bank of content, that is, you can repurpose that. You can change it, you can repurpose it in different forms. And this is something which a good, like my the first head of growth that worked for me, Daphne Tiedemann, shared with me. It was really impactful for her to create these type of assets and grow her business right now. So the question is, which asset has the highest reinvention potential? So you start by thinking, how can I create something that can be repurposed? In an information business, for example, you can take two routes. So the intense route, so this is a route that I just took. You first write a book, then you turn that into blog posts, then you can turn that into social media posts, keynotes, etc. So you start big, yeah, as with Superconnector Media, they started high and then moved down the chain. Or the other way around, you create a series of blog posts and social media posts and other types of assets, and then you turn that into a book. So you can either go from top to down or from bottom to up. That's with an information business. But if you look at a software as a service business, what you can do is you can start with consulting, set up a process, and then you digitize parts of that process. As you digitize those human touches, and because of that, you can create a cheaper version of your consulting. Or at the other hand, if you already have digital feature, if you already have some digital products, you can increase the value by adding human touch by specific consulting that is leveraged on what's already happening in a digital way. So to sum it up, what you really need to remember are these three things. Go to market within an ecosystem. Think from a value ladder perspective. Eh? Don't treat it as a one-off, but think, how is this thing that I'm going to launch, where I'm going to go to market with, is going to make my ecosystem better? You need to think in leveraging digital and human touches. You want to make sure that you find the optimal return on investment. Look at how flexible it is. Look how fixed it is. Because in that combination, that's where you can find the ultimate return on investment. And always build with repurposing in mind. Yeah? Don't just start, but think, okay, how can I do things and make sure that I can repurpose it in another way? If you want more information about that, it's the touch-based value ladder, working once and get paid forever with modular asset. It's all in my book, which is launching soon. And I want to thank Pep a lot for this speaking opportunity again. Yeah, and really curious about all the questions.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Chris. Before we'll take audience questions and everybody post write your questions down, I have some questions of my own to start.
So I was already afraid of that.
your examples were, you know, content, consulting, coaching related. So how would I use this in a SaaS setting, and have you seen companies do that?
Yeah, so the biggest problem within tech and IT is, of course, building a feature before you actually know that it will resonate. So what I always try to do is pre-sell features. And so you go to a company and say, you know what, we're missing this. And you then ask them, so for example, for if you just pay $2,000 right now and you can use this for the rest of your life for free, would you then do it? And if you then have sold that in a human way, in that human touch, then you know that digital touch will actually be an acceleration.
Gotcha. Yeah. I've seen, you know, if you talk about SaaS products, like ClickFunnels is a tool where if you sign up, there's a massive upsell ladder. I think you need to go through 12 upsell offers before you can even sign up for the tools. And it's not really a nice experience. I don't remember how they do it, but like, is there a formula in terms of these, the value ladder steps of like, how much more expensive should the next offer be? Is it like each one is like 60% more expensive, you know, 250%? Is there a formula?
I don't know if there's a formula, but I can remember sitting in Austin during the first version of CXL Live, where somebody was explaining that he created an online course on CRO, where there was an offer where people could get email access or full one-on-one personal coaching with him, which was a 15K offer that nobody bought, but he installed it as a decoy or as an anchor. And I think that you can remember that that story, because that's actually what you told me. So what I always say, have a more expensive product, which you might not even sell, but use it as anchoring, because it puts the other things that you have into more perspective.
That's right. Yeah. Let's take some questions from the audience here. So Wasim is asking, how can we apply the ladder system in a B2C insurance industry? The sign up can't be free there, and the audience is also not very interested in booklets.
Yeah. So the first thing that I always say is, in some industry, the concept of a value ladder with ClickFunnels, like you can, they can sell like 10, 12 products. In other industries, it's maybe two or three, or maybe only just one. So the best way to answer this is to analyze your current customer base and see in which sequence, in which time frames they're already buying from you. Because if you do that, you can then ask yourself the question, are you already facilitating that buying journey in the easiest way possible? And in 9 out of 10 cases, companies are not doing that yet. So first, already see what's already working and how can I make that easier for my current customers?
Cool. Warren is asking, love the digital versus human touch thinking. Chris, do you ever think of your value ladder in terms of setting up the ideal sales conversation? So the place, digital or in real life, where you have the best chance of selling people.
Yes. So what I think, to reflect on that question and to answer it in my personal context. So what I say is that, like, I can teach you how to do, for example, CRO or another process, but there are probably a lot of other people who are better at that. And you don't need my one-on-one time to get the best results out of that, like following a course or following a guideline that has a lot of impact, that can have all the impact that's necessary. But you hire me for the one-on-one time to add those things to your specific context and see where the ultimate leverage and value is over there. And what I do is try to combine those two things. So my one-on-one time is really expensive. It's what some say, but I guide you to all kinds of online resources like CXL, like others, where they can learn the things which can be learned in a digital way.
Cool. We're out of time. Chris, thank you so much. Everybody, if you have further questions to Chris, he's on LinkedIn. Anywhere else where people should find you?
LinkedIn, extremerevenuegrowth.io is a new site that I'm soon launching, chrisout.com. Feel free to reach out. I'm happy to help.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Chris.